Good evening. Welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study here at the Trinity Gardens Church of Christ. I'm Brother Thorn, one of the ministers here. I'm delighted to be a part of your evening, and I also appreciate that you're inviting me into your homes and your personal spaces by way of Facebook and YouTube. We're continuing our study, The Will to Win, and tonight we will look at it from a different angle. I know the past few weeks we looked at it from the standpoint of things that worked in competition with our will, particularly the lack of confidence, voids in our lives, and also feeling like an outsider in your family. Well, tonight and in the next couple of weeks going forward, we're going to look at some things in the scripture that will give us the reassurance to win, the reassurance that we can win, because God has put us in a position to win. He has given us the things that we need to be winners. Our text for this evening will come from Psalm 28:7. It reads, and I'm reading from the New International Version, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts him and he helps me." So the title for the message this evening is simply, "The Lord is my strength," because as we fight our battles, we need that reassurance that our supply of strength is not absent, even though the battles may become difficult. The Lord is my strength. Please bow with me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for allowing things to be as well with us as they are. Even though things are not perfect and sometimes we wish that they would be better, we thank you for just allowing them to be as they are. We're thankful because you're with us. We're thankful because you still love us. We thank you because you're still merciful. We thank you because you continue to extend grace. We thank you for sending your son Jesus, who died on Calvary's cross so that we could have access to eternal life. We thank you, Father, for just allowing us to be involved in your kingdom and to be used as vessels to bring glory and honor to you. It is our prayer, Lord, that as we study tonight, that the information we share will serve as a catalyst and stimulate growth in each of us. Bless those among us who are sick, comfort those who are bereaved, and continue to strengthen all of us. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord is my strength. My heart trusts him and he helps me. I'd like for us to think about that for a moment. The Lord is our strength. And I'll go into detail briefly about one way of looking at the strength we receive from the Lord. But not only is he our strength, he's our shield. That means he protects us. And because he's our strength and our shield, in our hearts, we're able to trust him, knowing that he will help us. The Lord is our strength. In our study, when we read our Bible and we look at different events, from time to time, we see the Lord asking us and expecting us to do things that don't make sense. And when we look at those things that we've been asked to do, being that we are human and we like to look out for our own best interest, we wonder, how is it possible to do what we need to do for God and still win and still be successful? Let me share some instances from the scripture where people were told to do things that didn't make sense. In Matthew chapter 19, verse number 22, we see Jesus having a conversation with his disciples. But not only that, he told this rich young man to give everything that he had to the poor and to follow him. And so listen to what the disciples said to Jesus after he had that conversation with that rich man, or as some often refer to him, the rich young ruler, Jesus said to his disciples, "Truly I tell you, it is hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven." When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished and asked, "Who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man, this is impossible. With God, all things are possible." And then listen to what Peter's response was. Peter said, "We have left everything to follow you. What then will they be for us?" Do we see that? He tells the ruler to leave his riches. Then he continues the thought and says, "Hey, it's easier for a camel to go through a needle than it is for a rich man to make it to heaven." And then when he finishes up, Peter says, "Wait a minute. We've given up everything to follow you. What then will there be for us?" Jesus allowed these men to give up everything to follow him. He did not discourage them to turn around. He let them follow him. And Peter is now wondering, "Hey, how do we benefit from all of this?" There's another instance in which Jesus says something that didn't make sense in Luke chapter 14. Please turn with me to Luke chapter 14. And listen to what the Bible says in Luke chapter 14, beginning at verse number 25 and reading from the New International Version. "Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, 'If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple.'" Now, Lord, wait a minute. You are love. You are the perfect example of love. But you're telling me that if I want to follow you, I need to hate my family? Well, no, he's not saying that. He's saying that the amount of love that we have for him in comparison to the amount of love we have for our families should be as far as love is from hate. So you mean to tell me, Jesus, that as a husband, father, a sibling, that I'm supposed to love you that much more than people in my household in order to be your disciple? Then you tell me I got to carry my own cross. Cross was an instrument of death. That I gotta carry my own cross. I gotta take some risk, even if it includes my life, to follow you. That's another thing that was taught by Jesus that from a carnal and human mindset does not make sense. Let's look at another example in Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, starting at verse number 57 in Luke chapter 9, as they were walking along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." This is a man talking to Jesus. Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But the man replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." Jesus replied, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom." So wait a minute. You mean to tell me that in order to be a committed follower of Christ, I got to be willing to not have a home? I cannot go back and bury my father. I can't go tell my family goodbye. Wait a minute, Lord. What am I really getting into? Again, this is another example of Jesus giving instructions that did not make sense. In Luke chapter 10, Luke chapter 10, verses 1 through 4, we see him appointing 72 people to go out and teach. The Bible says, after this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them out two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest fields. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse, a bag, or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. Again, Jesus is telling people to travel, leave money at home. Don't be buddy-buddy with anybody you meet on the road. He's sending them out as lambs among wolves. Well, Lord, why is it that, again, you're asking someone to do something that doesn't make sense? Verse 17, the Bible says, the 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. Now, when we look at this, with the Lord asking his followers to do things that doesn't make sense, well, he can do that because even though we may be in a vulnerable position, he's still in control. He's still our strength. He's still our shield. And even though things that he tells us to do do not make sense and they appear to be impossible, he's still our protection. He's still our strength. And we're able to trust him in the face of impossibility. With people, things are impossible. But with God, all things are possible. There are other things from a practical living standpoint that he expects us to do that makes no sense. Loving our enemies make no sense. I mean, I could just imagine being in that audience when the Lord said, hey, love your enemies. I probably would have been the one to say, Jesus, are you serious right now? This must be some type of joke. This must be one of those mysterious parables you're teaching. Or when he says, forgive those who mistreat us so that we can inherit the kingdom. Now, who in their right mind would voluntarily do that? Or what about when he teaches us that one of the fruit of the Spirit is to be patient? We live in a fast-paced world where at the push of a button, we have access to tons of information. Push of a button, we could watch what we want to watch on television. We can order goods and services. Push of a button without ever having to leave home if we did not want to. So we live in a high pace, a high intense, a high pace, a fast, high impact is the word I'm looking for, world. But he tells us to be patient. Really, Lord? Why is that expectation in there? Because we look around and we see others living a fast-paced life and getting ahead, but you want us to be patient, especially when it comes to circumstances we'd rather not deal with? Well, here's why he can tell us to be patient, because he's our strength. He's our shield. So even though it may appear that the world is passing us by, as long as we are obedient to him, he guarantees that he's our strength. And he's our shield. And therefore, that lets us know that our hearts can trust him. The Lord is qualified to ask us to do impossible things because, first of all, he knows everything. Our God is an all-knowing God. Now, when we look at what does he know? Does he not only know what's going on right now? He knows more than what's going on right now. He knows about what will happen as well. So he knows what did happen. He knows what can happen. And he also knows what will happen. We don't have a view of the future. All we have are past experiences and things that we are experiencing right now. So when we're dealing with God, one of the reasons why we can be confident in his ability to strengthen and protect us, it's because he also knows what's going on in the future. So the best that we can do, since we don't know the future, but we know who holds it, is to take him at his word. So here's what we can learn from him in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. The Apostle Paul tells us, says, therefore, we do not lose heart, that applies to us too. Neither should we lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed or strengthened day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is unseen is temporary, what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So here's where trusting God comes in. We got to trust that when we do things that he asks us to do that don't make sense, where we don't readily see the outcome, that it's going to lead us to an eternal celebration with him. Yes, it may not make sense now. It may cause people to even question our sanity or even to question our commitment that we made to him. But remember, he's already paved the way and he's already designed the outcome. So in the meantime, while we're living and walking and traveling into the unknown, let us be mindful that as we walk this unknown path and participate in this unknown and unseen journey, that the Lord is our strength. He is our shield. And guess what? We can trust him. Another thing about looking toward the future when we walk with God, there's a principle that he put in place called reaping and sowing. We know what that's about. Some of you have gardens, whether you have these big, huge gardens where you need a tractor to work them, or if you have a small garden where you can just go out on the weekends for a few hours with your gloves and your small tools and work for a few hours there. Reaping and sowing. You sow a seed, it's going to grow into a plant, develop fruit, and we reap those fruit. Well, that principle applies to the spiritual sense as well. In Galatians chapter 6, starting at verse 7, the Bible says, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life." So what he's letting us know, if we put more value on investing into life right now, guess what? We'll reap some things, but it's going to all be destroyed at some point. He wants us to do things that do not make sense so that we can sow seeds into the spiritual aspect of our lives. And when we sow seed into the spiritual aspect of our lives, he says that we will reap eternal life. The benefit from doing that is obtaining eternal life. And guess what? He knows that. He knows what the future holds. So it is important for us to remember that as we walk with him, this unknown pathway, and we cannot see what tomorrow holds, that he's our strength, he's our shield, and we can trust him. Another reason he can make demands on us is because he is always with us. Wherever we are, we don't have to second guess. Our God is always present. And I remember singing a song, that we sing from time to time, rather, that says, "Take the Lord with you everywhere you go." But you know what? We don't have to take the Lord with us anywhere because he's already there. Listen to what the Bible says in Psalm 139, verse number 7. The Bible says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast." Now, the psalmist points out that there's no way we can flee from the presence of God. He says if we go up to the heavens, he's there. He says that even if we go to the lowest of the low places, that God is there as well. He even talks about that if we ride the wings of a new morning, if we are riding the wings of the new morning, that talks about time. God is there as well. And he even says that if we settle on the far side of the sea, have you ever gone to the beach and you looked out into the water and you can't see anything but water as far as your eye can view. All right, the picture that he's painting is even if we go so far out in the sea that, you know, a place that the mind, that the eyes cannot visualize, that God is there with us as well. And not only is he there, he will be there to give us guidance, and he and his right hand will hold us fast. The right hand historically is viewed as the stronger of the two hands. So even if we're in a faraway place that cannot be seen, our God is there. And guess what? He's holding us in our strong hand, in his strong hand, rather, protecting us, which again falls right in line with our proof text that the Lord is our strength. He's our shield. And we can trust him even if we've gone somewhere that our eyes have never seen. Not only does God know the outcome, he's already at the outcome. He's already at the end of the road. Let me explain where I'm coming from. Earlier, we talked about God knowing the future, but God is already in the future. In Proverbs 14:12, he illustrates a principle when he says, there's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is the way of death. Well, for those who don't follow the right way, God is already at the end of the road waiting for them. Jeremiah chapter 10:23, the Bible says, O Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man who walks to direct his own step. So if man's not directing his own step and we've submitted to God, then the conclusion we're able to draw is God is directing our step. Now, the question I have is, when you're directing someone's step, are you doing it from the rear or are you doing it from the front? Well, God's doing it from the front. He's directing our steps as our leader and our guide so that when we get to wherever we're going, he's already going to be there before us. Our God never leaves, nor does he ever forsake us. At one time, it was commonplace to refer to a loyal friend as being a ride or die person. That came from a hip hop song that was out years ago. But you know, God is greater than a person who would be considered a ride or die. Why is that? Because God's not going to ever die. In Psalm 90, the Bible says, before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So before the world was born, and even after the world goes away, guess what? God is still going to be around. How do we know that? Because he's from everlasting to everlasting. Now, when we look at Genesis chapter 1, and it talks about the creation, it opens up by saying, using the phrase rather, in the beginning. Well, when it talks about God's existence, you will not find an in the beginning. You will just find from everlasting. And when you talk about God's ending, you will not find an ending. You will find the phrase to everlasting. From everlasting to everlasting, he is our God. All right. And also, because he is from everlasting to everlasting, in Psalm 46:1, he is our present help when we are in trouble. Wherever we are, no matter what age we are, the Lord is our present help in time of trouble. We don't have to go look for him. We don't have to text him to see where he is. We don't have to use a phone app where we can just push the phone out and have his phone located based on the technology contained therein. He's our present help. That means wherever we are, he is. And not only is he there, he is our help when we are in trouble. So not only is he all present, our God is all powerful. Now, those of us who grew up going to Sunday school and things like that, we learned about his miracles. We learned about how at the Red Sea, Moses extended his staff, the sea opened. the Israelites, children of Israel, they walked across to safety. We also know about his experience with Ezekiel's experience with God in Ezekiel 37 in the Valley of Dry Bones, how he saw all of these dead bones. And the Lord asked him, is there life in these bones? Ezekiel responded, Lord, you know. And God worked it so that those dry bones came together, stood up, and became a mighty army. We know about Jesus feeding the multitude. Yes, a multitude of people by taking a kid's small lunch, 2 fish, 5 loaves, fed a multitude and had food left over. We also know about Jesus conquering illness throughout Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John's account of his work. He's all-knowing. He's not only able to perform miracles in nature, but he conquered illness. Now, I want us to think about that for a minute. We serve a God who's able to conquer illness. Now, along that line, just because we serve a healing God doesn't mean that we should not go to the doctor, because God works through medical science. His ability supersedes medical science, but he also uses medical science to accomplish his will. And as the all-powerful, he also empowers us. And as I get ready to close, I want to share some scriptures of encouragement so that we, as we go forward and fight each day, we can move forward with the assurance that the Lord expects us to win. In Psalm 46:10, he tells us to be still and know that he is God. What does that have to do with strength? That lets us know that that communicates to us that as long as we know that he's God, then we have the strength to be still and move when he says move and wait for him to work our situations out. In Isaiah 54:7, he says, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. In Romans 8:37, he refers to us as being more than conquerors. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 4, this spiritual warfare that we're in, he's blessed us with weapons that's able to pull down strongholds. The Lord is our strength and our shield. What do you mean by the Lord being our strength? God manifests his strength in at least 3 different ways. When we look at the notion of strength, let me say it that way. When we look at the notion of strength, it's manifested in at least 3 different ways. One way is physical strength. God has the ability to give us the mental and physical strength to overcome life's challenges. We call that resilience. We call that durability. We call that having the ability to persevere. Secondly, another way to look at strength is monetary strength. Now, when we look at the way things occur in society, people with money are able to make things happen that we don't believe can happen. They're able to make people do things that they would not normally do. Well, there are multi-billionaires and trillionaires on this earth. But guess what? God has more than they have. He has an unlimited supply of resources. And that lets me know that even though these people who are wealthy and influential can make things happen, God can do a whole lot more in this world than they can. It also refers to military might. Here in the United States, we have a strong army, and what makes our armed forces, rather, we have a strong military, and what makes our military so powerful is with the number of resources that it has access to, it's able to move efficiently, and when it arrives, it's able to be effective. Meaning, simply put, we can get there pretty quickly. And when our military gets there, it's able to complete its objectives. All right. Well, God is more powerful than all of the militaries of this world combined. The Bible still describes him in Psalm 24 as being mighty in battle. Now, when we look at the Lord's strength, it's mightier than any military might than we can ever imagine. And so as I get ready to close, going back to Psalm 28, the beginning part of verse 7, the Lord is my strength. All of those attributes, physical strength, financial, military, the Lord is that for all of us, and he's able to equip us with the things that we need when we need it. He's our shield, and because of that, our hearts are able to trust him. Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord and lean not on our own understanding, and he will direct our paths. Trust in the Lord, that describes what we do when we lay down in our beds. When we lay down in our beds, we don't have a worry because we know our beds are holding us. Well, what God wants us to know as we live this life and fight in these battles that we fight, don't lose our will to win because he's holding us. He got our back. He's holding us up. So don't give up, but instead continue to stand strong and allow him to strengthen us and shield us according to his good pleasure. Thank you for lending me your ears. And I pray that we shared something that would just make it possible for us to approach tomorrow with a stronger will to win than we had today or yesterday. May God bless you. May he keep you. And may his face continue to shine upon you.